Hello students, we look at current affairs for 9th May. These are the important keywords which come up in today's newspaper, the news items which have been picked up. So the first one is placid trial of ICMR. So Indian Council of Medical Research is conducting phase 2 trial, a clinical trial now on convalescent plasma therapy. So this is plasma which is part of the blood, the colorless part of the blood, which is taken, liquid which is taken, and which is from a recovered patient, from a patient which has who has recovered from COVID-19. So antibodies have developed in his blood, and this plasma is then given to another patient who has mild symptoms, and he gets the antibodies and can recover from COVID-19. So the trial is going on this. So that is called placid trial. You should be aware of that. And second is strict liability versus absolute liability. So this is in the context of the news which we saw yesterday, the Vizag gas leak case. In this, National Green Tribunal has taken slow motor cognizance of the case and has asked the company, the LG Polymers, to make a payment of 50 crore rupees. But this is under strict liability. So strict liability is said to be a colonial era term, English old law term, and this does not bring in absolute liability. There are various exemptions given to companies because of which they may not end up paying full compensation. So though compensation has been asked for, lawyers have raised concern that why NGT has used the term strict liability, which has already been made redundant, means irrelevant in Indian context, because Supreme Court in 1986 in a ruling had said there will be no strict liability but absolute liability, and all courts should use absolute liability in case of such disasters where companies are to be held liable. The next is regarding Babri Masjid demolition case. Here the Supreme Court has put a deadline again for the criminal case which is going on in Babri Masjid demolition, in which BJP leaders are involved. CBI court is hearing the case. The next is UP temporary exemption from labor laws ordinance. So UP, the Pradesh government, Yogi Adityanath government, has passed an ordinance which is calling for temporary exemption from almost 30 of the 40 labor laws as such for 3-year period. So post COVID-19, to give a boost to the economy, labor laws have been suspended, which of course left parties have raised concern on that, why rights of laborers should be affected and why prosecution should not be taken against employers if labor laws are violated. So but then this ordinance is still not going to be effective until the central government approves it, because labor falls in concurrent list. So central government will have to approve this ordinance to make it effective, and various other states are also considering such laws. Then next is Patriot missile systems. So this is anti-defense missile system. So this is anti-missile system actually. So this is belonging to USA and has been stationed across continents, and this one in Asia, in Saudi Arabia, is being recalled now. So it was placed after it was said there was threat from Iran, but now USA administration says that threat from Iran is no longer existing. So it has decided to remove these Patriot missile systems from Saudi Arabia. Then this is phase 1 trade deal, which is related to China, US-China trade deal. So though there are accusations by President Trump against China, but phase 1 trade deal will continue to be on track, is what has been an assuring message coming from both the country's trade leaders. Then about the 75 years to end of World War II. World War II ended in 1945, so 2020 comes to 75 years to the end of the Second World War. Then here you have regarding Olive Ridley turtles, the hatching has begun on Orisha coast in Rishikulya Rookery. So that's in news. You should know everything about Olive Ridley turtles too. Then this is IFSC Gift City, which is International Finance Services Center. So which has been established in India. The first IFSC established in India is Gift City, which is in Gandhinagar, Gujarat. So that is International Finance Tech City. So this is regarding that, this has been in news because it has started rupee dollar derivative. So that will be initiated in Gift City now. Then what is derivative trading also is important. We have discussed that too. So we'll see that. Then this is regarding AIIB, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. India has borrowed $500 million from AIIB. So that's in news. And regarding female genital mutilation, today we have the editorial on it too. Sudan has abolished female genital mutilation. It had already, many states had abolished it. Now it has been made into a criminal offense too, with 3 years behind bars and fine for this practice as such. What is female genital mutilation? We'll see that, as well as how it is prevalent in some communities in India too. So let's start with it. So these are the 20 news items which have been picked up from the Hindu newspaper. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, likely treatments for COVID-19. So ICMR has initiated a PLACID trial. We already discussed that. It's a multi-center clinical trial, means various centers across the country have been approved for conducting this trial. It is in phase 2. It's an open-label randomized controlled trial to assess the safety and efficacy of convalescent plasma therapy. So that is it. And the study has received approval from COVID-19 National Ethics Committee. There are other treatments also which are highlighted, like there are other treatment options, like remdesivir is used, one. Then lopinavir, ritonavir is used, ritonavir. Then lopinavir, ritonavir with ribavirin and interferon beta-1a is used. And fourth treatment is chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, which are anti-malarial drugs. So remdesivir is actually a drug which was manufactured originally to treat Ebola virus. And now it has been found effective against COVID-19 too, the coronavirus. Then as we saw, lopinavir, ritonavir are used for treating HIV. Ribavirin is used to treat chronic hepatitis C virus. And injectable interferon beta-1. Interferon beta-1 is used by multiple sclerosis patients. So these are being found effective. But then none have been approved yet. So these are the treatment options presently available. So, and these are being used because those are the medicines which we have to fight the disease now, till a vaccine develops. So number of deaths you can see are increasing. Both Maharashtra and Gujarat have consistently recorded a high share of India's cases as well as deaths. And this is convalescent plasma therapy detailed out, how you can see the blood plasma is taken. So blood is drawn and then virus neutralizing antibodies are taken as a serum and given to a COVID-19 patient. So he was a patient who has recovered now. So his plasma is then injected into a COVID-19 mild symptom patient. So many trials have begun in Kerala too for it and are shown to be favorable. And it is said this is not a new treatment. The idea of using one person's plasma to help another has been used even during the outbreak of SARS. It's transfusion. One person's donation of plasma can help two people. Scientists say that a patient needs only one transfusion to get enough antibodies to fight the virus. The next is 16 MP migrants run over by train near Aurangabad. So 16 migrant laborers aged between 20 and 30 were trying to return to their home state Madhya Pradesh on foot were killed when a goods train ran over them in Maharashtra. They were in between Jalna and Aurangabad. They were working at a steel firm in Maharashtra Industrial Development Corporation Zone, MIDC, in Jalna district. So 16 have died, one was seriously injured, 3 have escaped. So this was wee hours in the morning when this tragedy happened. The next is National Green Tribunal directs LG Polymers to deposit 50 crores. So NGT has taken slow motor cognizance of the styrene gas leak case and has directed LG Polymers India to deposit an initial amount of rupees 50 crore for the damage caused. So in this case, at least 11 people have died and several others have been seriously affected. So NGT has also issued notice to Andhra Pradesh Pollution Control Board, Central Pollution Control Board and Union Minister of Environment seeking their response to in the matter. It has also constituted a 5-member fact-finding committee to be headed by former judge of AP High Court to probe the incident. So styrene gas is actually a hazardous chemical and under relevant rules, on-site, off-site emergency plans should be in place and it appears that these plans failed. And it is because of rules were not being complied is evident. So it appears to be the case. So fact-finding committee will bring in further details too. So the company is held liable. it has asked, it has put strict liability on the company, and this has been criticized. Lawyers say that the term absolute liability should have been used instead of strict liability by National Green Tribunal. Also, you should know about National Green Tribunal. It is headed by a judge. So it is its chairperson is Justice Adarsh Kumar Goel. And National Green Tribunal is a tribunal which has been established in the country to look into environment related cases so that the courts are not burdened with environment cases and they are looked up here. So the strict liability principle being used means the company is liable, but it may not pay compensation if hazardous substance escaped its premises by accident or by an act of God. So there are exceptions, you know, concessions given here in strict liability principle. It is said to be 19th century English law principle. And this has become obsolete or redundant in the country because Supreme Court in 1986 case, this was oleum gas leak case in Delhi, it said strict liability is completely inadequate to protect citizens' rights. And that's why absolute liability principle should be used. And this was the time when just 2 years back, 1984 Bhopal gas tragedy had happened. And that time the Chief Justice of Supreme Court was P.N. Bhagwati. So he had given this ruling that absolute liability principles should be used, and it said that it should be mandatory for the company to pay compensation whether or not disaster was caused by its negligence. So you can see this was the ruling. So here you can see strict liability is a term has evolved in English law. 1868 English law called Rylands versus Fletcher case, which provided companies with several exemptions from assuming liability. So, an absolute liability, there is no escape, no exemption. Then next is, Supreme Court asks states to consider online sale of liquor. So, actually there was a petition filed in the Supreme Court against government circular of 1st May allowing direct contact sale of liquor across the country. So this petition which was filed said that there are around 70,000 liquor vans and shops nationwide and over 5 crore people had purchased liquor from them. So this, if liquor shops have seen such videos and images of people, how they crowd to liquor shops. So the petition said that there will be a rise in COVID-19 cases if shops are opened in this manner. So it had filed a petition in the Supreme Court, but Supreme Court dismissed the petition against the government circular. And the Supreme Court left it open for the states, that states can consider, because the petition was calling for online sale. So it said states can consider online sale and home delivery of liquor. And it has asked them to ensure that steps can be taken, but the petition was dismissed. The next is deliver Babri case verdict by August 31. So the Supreme Court has directed CBI court, which is looking into this case. So it's a CBI court, CBI judge S.K. Yadav, who is looking into the case. So Supreme Court has asked it to deliver the judgment by August 31, 2020. We had seen how a deadline was imposed by former Chief Justice of India in the Babri Masjid title dispute case too, in which the dispute on who owns the land was there. So former CJI, he put a deadline before his retirement and he ensured that the case is the judgment is delivered by him only. That was Justice Ranjan Gogoi. And now this is regarding the criminal case in the Babri Masjid dispute, the act of demolishing the Babri Masjid. So in this, various senior BJP leaders are accused, including L.K. Advani, Murli Manohar Joshi and Uma Bharti. So they are accused of criminal conspiracy which led to the demolition of the 16th century Babri Masjid by car sevaks in Ayodhya on 6 December 1992. Post which riots took place all across the country. So there are two cases basically, and CBI court is hearing these cases. One is Rae Bareli case, which accuses BJP and Sangh Parivar leaders of having given speeches that promoted enmity and threatened nation's integrity. And next is the Lucknow case, which has been investigated by CBI against lakhs of unknown car sevaks. So these car sevaks demolished the Babri Masjid. So this is a case against these unknown car sevaks, and it deals with the actual act of demolition and violence. So both the cases have been clubbed together, and the accused leaders are being tried on a composite charge sheet which has been filed by the CBI in 1993. So the Supreme Court transferred this Rae Bareli case also to CBI court in Lucknow for joint trial. And the CBI case in Lucknow has been heard in 2017. Supreme Court said, let justice be done through the, though the heavens fall. Means it should be wrapped up. So it came, it used its extraordinary powers under Article 142 of the Constitution to bring the cases to justice. And it wanted them to be wrapped up in 2 years. But then it was seen that the judgment did not come. So now in 2019, Apex Court asked the UP government to give an extension to the tenure of the judge, to the CBI judge hearing the case, Justice Yadav, so that he could complete the trial in this 25-year-old case. And also it extended the 2-year deadline which it had given for delivering the judgment. So now it has asked the CBI judge, Judge Yadav, to take advantage of video conferencing facility and complete the evidence in the trial and wind up the case. So it has asked the case to be, Supreme Court has asked the CBI court to wind up the case by August 31, 2020. So this is the entire timeline. The mosque was built in 1527 and named after Babur as Babri Masjid. Baba was the first Mughal emperor of India. In 1949, the site was declared disputed after Hindu groups claimed that idols of Lord Ram miraculously came in the mosque premises under the central dome of the mosque. And in 1984, VHP, Vishwa Hindu Parishad, spearheaded movement to construct temple at the site, claiming it to be the birthplace of Lord Ram. And since then, we see 1992, the Babri Masjid demolition took place and riots broke out all across the country. 2002, and again, when Hindu activists were returning from Ayodhya, they were killed in Godhra, which triggered Gujarat riots, and nearly 2,000 people were killed. That is a low estimate as such. Then 2009, Liberan Commission was gave its report on the Babri Masjid demolition, in which it blamed top BJP leaders, including L.K. Advani, for instigating activists to raise the mosque. 2011, Supreme Court actually suspended the Allahabad High Court ruling on the title dispute of splitting the site between Hindus and Muslims. And in 2019, the Supreme Court verdict came on Babri Masjid title dispute, in which the land was allotted to the Hindus and the Muslims would get another plot and another place for constructing a mosque. So this is the Babri Masjid demolition case. So we'll get a verdict in this too soon. Then next is U.S. Special Envoy urges India to talk to Taliban. So U.S. Special Representative for Afghanistan Reconciliation, Zalmay Khalilzad, has asked India to engage with Taliban directly. So USA has initiated talks with Taliban and it is asking India to start talks with Taliban too, because U.S. says India has a significant role in Afghanistan's development. But India does not talk to terror groups and it still considers Taliban a terror group allied to Pakistan, and has distanced itself from any talks. Next is Vande Bharat mission to cover more European nations. So Vande Bharat mission, which was initially for in the phase one, started for Gulf nations as well as for Europe and UK, US and other countries. Now it has been extended to cover even Russia, Ukraine, Germany, Spain and even East Europe. So Indians abroad are being brought back to the country under Vande Bharat mission. So this is for the flights which are bringing back the Indians. Also, the Navy is involved in bringing back Indians in the island nations like Maldives. So that is called Samudra Setu project. So there are two different missions running for Air India and the Navy working on this. Then next is major labor laws suspended in UP for 3 years. So Yogi Adityanath government has finalized Uttar Pradesh temporary exemption for labor laws ordinance, suspending more than 30 labor laws in the state for 3 years. So it says this will help both existing and new industrial units in the state. So you can see there are around 40 different labor laws. So around 8 of them have been retained. Others have been suspended for 3 years. So those which have been retained include Bonded Labor Act, Employee Compensation Act and Building Under Construction Workers Act. Also related to Maternity Act, Equal Remuneration Act, Child Labor Act, Payment of Wages Act have been retained. So Payment of Wages Act states that wages of a person earning less than 15,000 a month cannot be deducted. So this is there, but the other labor laws that like settling of industrial disputes, health and working conditions of workers, trade unions, contract workers, migrant workers, those laws, labor laws related to them have been frozen for 3 years. So owners of factories have been given more power to hire and fire without attracting punitive measures from the labor department. Also, this new ordinance prevents enforcement wing from raiding the premises of factories on minor issues. But then labor is a concurrent subject, so UP government ordinance will have to be approved by the central government so that it can be enforced. So now it is awaiting central government approval. Then next is Manipur Speaker reserves decision on disqualification of 7 legislators. So Manipur Assembly Speaker has reserved his decision. This is actually a regard against 7 Congress MLAs. So Congress MLAs supported BJP-led coalition government in the state, and BJP was able to come to power. And Congress approached the Supreme Court for disqualification of these 7 MLAs because they helped the BJP. So BJP actually got 10 seats less than the majority. Manipur has 60 legislative assembly seats and BJP got 21. So to get majority, it wanted 10 more seats to make it 31 in the 2017 assembly elections. So now in 2020, it has used these tactics to have Congress members supporting it. Congress got 28 seats and has formed the government here in a coalition. So Congress MLAs are being poached by BJP here, you can be seen. And Congress has approached Supreme Court for disqualification of these. Actually, a disqualification on grounds of defection, the decision is taken by the speaker. So speaker has actually disqualified one former forest minister who defected to the BJP, but apart from that, he has not given his decision on other 7 Congress MLAs. Then next is US pulls out Patriot missile batteries from Saudi Arabia. So US is pulling out 4 of its powerful Patriot missile systems from Saudi Arabia after determining that threat from Iran that sparked an arms buildup in the region in 2019 had waned. So 2 of the missile batteries were deployed after the September 2019 attack on Saudi oil installations, and 2 were installed earlier. So both are now being revoked. So USA is going to take them back. So this, you should remember, September 2019 attack, which was actually the Houthi rebels in Yemen who were blamed for the attack. They had taken responsibility too, but then Houthi rebels are said to be supported by Iran. So they had attacked US, they had attacked Saudi Arabia oil giants Aramco's processing facilities as such, which had heavily damaged these 2 processing facilities of Saudi Arabia, halving its oil production. So that time, Patriot missile systems were installed by US in Saudi Arabia, but now they have been taken back. And even 2 which have been earlier installed. And the reason being that there is no Iranian threat anymore here. So Patriot missiles, they are anti-defense, they are anti-missile systems. So they are owned by USA, and they have been deployed in various parts, you can see, of the continent of the world, like in Europe, in Asia, in West Asia. Here you will get a detailed coverage too. Here you can see they're located in Romania, Turkey, Spain, Poland. So they have these high resolution radars which detect missiles, incoming missiles, and destroy them. They have surveillance satellites with infrared technology which give the information which is relayed to the interceptor controller in the US, and the incoming missile is picked. Then next is China-US commit to implement trade deal despite rollover virus. So this is regarding phase one trade deal between USA and China. So though US President Donald Trump has accused China of spreading COVID-19 and claiming that it came out from a top security lab in Wuhan in China, it was leaked from there. So US President Trump has also asked threatened that new tariffs will be imposed against China for this, for spreading COVID-19. But still, we are seeing that phase one trade deal would be put into effect. US and Chinese trade representatives met and they agreed to create favorable conditions for phase one trade deal, which was signed in January 2020, much before COVID-19 outbreak came prominently in news. So how tariffs would be gradually reduced in this phase one, you can see. This shows the tariffs which have been imposed. You can see tranche 4A is the tariff at 15%. Tranche 1 was at 25%, tranche 2 at 25%, and tranche 3 at 10 to 25%. And there are more threatened also. So how now, these Chinese goods which have been subject to higher US tariffs and which are threatened with higher tariffs too, how they are going to be reduced. So as part of the phase one trade deal, Trump administration dropped the threatened tariffs. So these will no longer be implemented under phase one and cut the tariff rate for tranche 4A, the last one, from you can see 15% to 7%. But tranche 1 to 3 remain unchanged. This remains at 25% tariff on these goods continue. So that is just the phase one where tranche 4A and the threatened tariffs are being eliminated. So tranche 3 also was at 10%, but then raised to 25% in May 2019. So 1, 2, 3 tranches are tariffs at 25%. Means 25% duty being imposed by US on these Chinese goods. The next is Europe-US mark 75 years since end of Second World War. So 75 years since end of Second World War in Europe is being observed as such, but while the pandemic is on, the parades and commemoration events have been cancelled or scaled down. But this was a time when Nazi Germany was defeated in Europe. So the World War II finally ended when, after Japan surrendered, after Hiroshima and Nagasaki atomic bombs were blasted on August 6 and August 8 respectively by USA. But Germany surrendered on May 7, 1945. So end of World War II in Europe is this date, May 7, which was observed. And end of World War II was on August 8 after Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombing. So in Europe also there were Allied invasion of France and Germany was surrounded, even with USSR assistance, and finally Germany surrendered after Hitler committed suicide on 7th May 1945. The next is Pakistan court orders auction of ex-Taliban chief's property. So Pakistani judge ordered the auction of 5 properties purchased by former Taliban chief Mullah Akhtar Mansur. So here it is said he purchased these properties with fake documents and he was killed in a US drone strike in Balochistan province in 2016. So Pakistani court has ordered auctioning his properties. And Mullah Akhtar Mansur actually replaced Taliban founder Mullah Muhammad Omar. Mullah Muhammad Omar was also killed. He died in 2015 and in a drone attack, Mansur was also killed in 2016. So it is said he purchased these properties which are estimated to be worth $2 lakh. So now they will be auctioned by Pakistan. Then next is India sends essential medicines to Colombo. So we have sent a gift consignment of essential medicines to Sri Lanka as part of the ongoing COVID-19 assistance in the neighborhood. So this is 12.5 ton consignment of essential medicines. Next is Sudan criminalizes female genital mutilation. So Sudan has criminalized carrying out female genital mutilation, making it punishable by 3 years in jail. It is said some 87% Sudanese women aged between 14 and 49 have undergone some form of female genital mutilation. So though it has been restricted by states, still the practice continues. And it can have harmful effects. It is said female genital mutilation can result in urinary tract infections, uterine infections, kidney infections, cysts, reproductive issues, and even pain during sex. So there's a widespread cultural belief here that it is essential for girls' reputation to have female genital mutilation and or it will improve her future marriage prospects. So the practice is prevalent, it is said by UNICEF, in 29 countries in Africa and the Middle East. And out of these 29 countries, at least 24 countries have legislation or some form of decree against female genital mutilation, but still the practice continues. So even in Sudan, it is said it was already illegal in some states, but the bans were ignored. So parliament earlier under Omar al-Bashir, Sudan was under Omar al-Bashir, it had rejected the recommendations for banning female genital mutilation But after he was toppled, his government was toppled in April 2019, now we are seeing steps have been taken to improve the conditions of women. Women were actually at the forefront of toppling his government too. So in November 2009, Sudan also repealed a restrictive public order law that controlled how women acted and dressed up in public. So how they are dressed in public was also restricted, but these laws have now been repealed. So this is female genital mutilation. It is actually a harmful traditional practice, and it is considered a serious violation of human rights too, in which cutting or removing or sewing clothes of female genital flesh organ is done. So it can lead to death or serious health complications too, and can lead to severe complications in childbirth and chronic infections too. So it's called khavs. It has been practiced in India too by Dawoodi Bohra Muslims. So there's a petition in the Supreme Court on this too. Then next is, Government of India borrows $500 million from Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. So India has borrowed $500 million. This is part of the $1.5 billion project which has been co-financed by World Bank. So Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, which is led by China, is providing loan to us to support our emergency response to COVID-19 pandemic. So this fund can be helped to use to scale up procurement of personal protective equipments, oxygen delivery systems and medicines. So here you should know about Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. It was established in 2015, you can see. So it was an idea proposed by Chinese President Xi Jinping, and finally it was established, headquartered in Hong Kong, headquartered in Beijing. So these are the 21 founding members, and then UK and other countries have also joined in. So it's not just Asian countries which are part of Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. So it is basically to provide investment, infrastructure investments. You can see. So it's a comparison with Asian Development Bank, which is shown here, number of members and the capital. It started off with $100 billion capital target. So it's a comparison here, you can see. World Bank, Asian Development Bank, IMF, and this is BRICS Bank and Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. These are new banks. Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank has $100 billion target and BRICS Bank of $50 billion. And here it is Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa. So these are the members here. And AIIB has many countries as members, including India. China has the major share in AIIB. Second comes India. So it's China is the largest shareholder. The comparison being shown among these global financial institutions, and their target, World Bank is to target is to reduce poverty and ensure sustainable development. IMF is to promote monetary stability. Asian Development Bank is again in Asian region to reduce poverty. And Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank was to address Asia's infrastructure gap. But presently, $500 million have been provided by AIIB to India to fight COVID-19. You can see the capital is in, it is headquartered in Beijing. World Bank in Washington, IMF in Washington. Asian Development Bank is headquartered in Manila, Philippines. And in World Bank and IMF, USA has veto power. Asian Development Bank has no veto power. And even in AIIB, China agreed to forego its veto power. So there is no veto power there too. And this is regarding BRICS Bank. BRICS Bank is amongst five nations only. And they are, how much contribution they have given is shown here. The initial capital. So it's, BRICS Bank is also known as New Development Bank, NDB, which is also aimed at funding infrastructure projects in developing countries. And also help, there's a contingency currency pool which will help countries forestall short-term liquidity pressures too. The next is, government raises borrowings to 12 lakh crore in financial year 2021. Means India's borrowing requirements, market borrowings actually, are when the revenue and expenditure do not meet up. So when receipts and expenditure do not meet up, government needs to borrow. So this is the fiscal deficit. So these borrowing requirements are known as fiscal deficit. So there's a target, how much percentage can it be? in the budget 2020-21, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman had kept the fiscal deficit target at 3.5% for 2020-21, the year financial year which started in March 2020. So it had gross borrowings estimated at 7.8 lakh crores. So this much borrowings we can do. This is our fiscal deficit. And this was higher than the last year's estimated market borrowings of 7.1 lakh crores. But now these gross borrowings will not be 7.8 lakh crores, but they will be at 12 lakh crores. So an additional 4.2 lakh crores has been provided for. Government has increased its borrowing requirement estimates. So because there will be a shortfall in revenue and there is a need to fight COVID-19 at this time. So this. So already you are seeing how World Bank is assisting. Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank is providing us money, and this is the arrangement being made in the laws, in the provisions which are there under the budget also, for increasing even the weekly borrowing target also has been increased from 21,000 crore to 30,000 crores. So this is the news. COVID-19 has led to rise in spending. Tax revenues are under pressure because economy is down. So tax revenues are also less. Disinvestment has been stalled because it will not give any returns. So government wants to have money in hand. So stimulus packages will be provided for. So that's why you can see that government's gross market borrowing has been raised. But then this will also result in higher fiscal deficit. So, fiscal deficit target of 3.5% will not be complied with. It seems fiscal deficit would be touch 5.5%. Then next is rupee dollar derivatives trading at GIFT City. So, this is rupee dollar derivative trading, which has been inaugurated through video conferencing by Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman at GIFT City, which is the International Financial Service Center of the country. So this rupee dollar derivative will have this currency instrument, it is said, will have demand, will have takers among foreign portfolio investors, even banking units located in International Financial Service Center, global banks, and even NRIs. So what is a derivative? We'll understand that too, and about GIFT City too. So this has been established in Gujarat. It is GIFT City means Gujarat International Financial Tech City, a global financial hub. It was proposed in 2007. And it has been expected to be ready in 10 years. So a significant part of it has already begun functioning presently too. GIFT City. So it's an international financial service center. So it's considered as an international center located in the country. So various banks, etc. are located in this IFSC, you can see. It has commercial plot to residential as well as social plot. International financial services can be provided in the country through this. And India also proposes to have more such IFSCs too. The first one is GIFT City in Gandhinagar. So it provides jurisdiction for carrying out international financial services domestically. So these financial services are considered to not have happened in India, but having international stature as such. And what is derivative trading? So derivatives are financial instruments whose value is derived from the underlying asset. So this is rupee dollar derivative, means the underlying asset's value decides the value of the derivative. So derivatives means because it is derived, value is derived as such. So that's the term. So it's a contract. So like a gold derivatives are quite prominent. So based on the price of gold, the derivative is actually only a contract, a statement. So whatever amount you are investing in this, its value will increase or decrease based on the value of the underlying asset. In this case, gold. And what we have inaugurated presently is rupee dollar derivative. So those are purchased and sold. Instead of actually purchasing and selling rupee or dollar or gold, this is being done. And the last news is mass hatching of olive ridley turtles begins at Odisha's Rishikulya Rookery. So, olive ridley turtles come for laying eggs. So, egg laying had started in March. You can see that is called mass nesting. So mass nesting process started in March, and now after around 45 to 60 days, hatching takes place. So these olive ridley turtles, female turtle, comes and lays eggs in, you know, it digs up and lays eggs. And because of the heat of the beach sand, these eggs hatch. And you can see olive ridley hatchlings, they come out. So to protect the eggs from predators and humans, Forest Department puts up metal net fencing also in this region. And this time, because of COVID-19, the human interference or involvement in this, you know, in this hatching process has been less. So now hatching has started. So you should know about these olive ridley turtles. Orisha is the major nesting ground in the world for olive ridley turtles. So across the coast here, you can see this is the Rishikulya River and Rishikulya Rukri mass nesting site. Then even here, you know, Mahanadi River, Gahirmatha are also other mass olive ridley nesting sites. And sporadic nesting takes place, means one-off nesting takes place across the coast. So this is the east coast of India. It also takes place along the west coast, Goa, and some stretches of Maharashtra see olive ridley turtle hatching too, mass nesting. So it's called olive ridley turtle because of its olive colored shell, and it weighs up to 50 kg, a full grown olive ridley. So eggs are laid, and then around 45 to 60 days, the hatchlings would come out. So they live in the oceans, but then to lay their eggs, females return to the same beach from where they first hatched. So Goa is perhaps the only other site on the western coast where turtles are found, these olive ridley turtles. So, but then because of the spread of tourism, Goa no longer sees such mass nesting to such an extent. So these olive ridley turtles are protected in the country also under Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. They are said to be the smallest and most abundant of all sea turtles in the world. They are found in warm waters in Pacific, Atlantic and Indian Oceans. Their numbers are declining. They are recognized as vulnerable in the IUCN Red List. So this is it. Also, this mass nesting is called Aribada. So you should know about this term too, Aribada. So twice a year, they migrate great distances to nest on the same beach year after year. The coast of Orisha is the largest mass nesting site in the world. And next comes the coasts of Mexico and Costa Rica. Threats for the turtles are huge fishing nets, trawlers, no, poaching for of the olive ridley turtles for their meat, shell, leather, etc. It is said approximately one hatchling survives to reach adulthood for every 1,000 hatchlings that enter the seawater. So that is their survival rate. So that is it. Thank you.